And we are back. Episode 5 of Art of the Experience. Welcome. We got a good one for you today. My guest is Don Dorsey. Don has been a part of so many things with Disneyland and Walt Disney World that it's going to be really tough to stay on topic, but we're going to try our best. Don, welcome. How are you?
Hey, Sam. Good to see you.
Thank you so much again. I want to start off before we get right to it. How I even know you is crazy. When I started working parades in 1995, I realized the joy of doing those late night rehearsals. There's something about being in the park in the middle of the night, no guests, just you and some floats. You know, I was a teenager driving floats, having fun, staying up all night thinking this is crazy. On a few of those rehearsals, most all of them, I kept seeing this guy walking around looking at every single speaker and every bit of the sound zone. I'm like, who's this Don Dorsey guy? And, you know, someone kind of tells me he helped create the fanfare for the Main Street Electrical Parade. He is the guy for the music. How did you start off?
Well, I was a college kid in 1972 and went to Disneyland with some friends to see the original version of the Main Street Electrical Parade, which had just opened, and was very, very impressed with the visual. And of course, the sound was amazing. It was all synthetic. And I had a Mini Moog synthesizer at home, and I sort of got a vision of, I would like to do that. I would like to be involved in something like this. Didn't have anything specific in mind, but I thought lights, music, entertainment in the middle of the night, this is fascinating. I want to be part of this. And one of the things that I walked away with that night was a memory that the beginning of the parade didn't have any particular impact. It just sort of faded up and then the parade appeared. Wow. And as I began thinking about it a while later, I thought maybe I could create some sort of an opening or a way to begin this parade. And when I had the opportunity to actually work on the parade, which was after America on Parade was gone away and Electrical Parade was coming back, I was able to pitch that idea to Bob Yanni and Jim Christensen, who was the music director on the original parade. And they liked the idea. I did a little demo and they could hear what it was going to be. And they had a bed for the announce and everything. And they said, okay, that's good. Do that. And wow. At that point, Jim Christensen just sort of handed me the keys to the soundtrack and said, spruce it up, make it sparkle, you know, make it perky, do whatever you think is appropriate to do. And, so I took it from there. And
wow. You basically gave it its heart and soul. Like when anyone thinks of Electrical Parade, they think of that fanfare.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Disneyland proudly presents our spectacular festival pageant of nighttime magic and imagination in thousands of sparkling lights and electro-synthomagnetic musical sounds. The Main Street Electrical Parade.
That's incredible. My mind was really blown, even way back then and even to this day, that, wow, I get to talk to the guy that had something to do with something as special to us all as Electrical Parade.
I think that the heart and soul of the Main Street Electrical Parade is two things. First of all, the tune, Baroque Hoedown, and the original recording that underlies all of the overlaid Disney melodies. There's a sound to that original recording from 1967, I believe, that is sort of a gritty, an overtone rich texture. I can't say much more than that. It just had its own sound character. And it had some variations in the tempo. It wasn't a strict clock, click, 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 click. It sort of ebbed and flowed. And it was short and sweet, a minute and 3 second loop. And there was just something about the character of that piece that I think sticks in your memory. And the second part is, I think that the parade reminds people subconsciously, if not consciously, of Christmas, because
Christmas lights. Yeah.
And there's something sort of innate in us that says, you know, if we put our mind to it, we could do that. We could build a parade.
It's almost a little homemade, a little bit crafty.
It had that accessibility, mm-hmm. That you could look at it and you could understand it. And it was just really fun and bright and kind of unexpected in the middle of Disneyland when it first came out.
Oh, yeah.
So I think those things sort of combined to make it make it stick, make it a favorite, and keep it coming back. And
I love it.
Looking forward to seeing it for the 50th.
Me too. And I didn't know how special it'd be, and super cheesy, but you know, having grown up with Electrical Parade when I was a kid, having you know, been able to drive all the floats in it when I was, you know, growing up, and now to take my kids to see it, like it's part of us. I love it. But you know what? So this show, I really wanted to focus on Epcot and all the Lagoon shows, because I know you had a huge role in that. And me having just returned from Epcot and Walt Disney World, but Epcot's my favorite park. I've always been interested in the Lagoon shows, and knowing that you had such a, you know, a special role in all those too. I want to dive into that, but I couldn't not start this off talking about your Electrical Parade connection. But you know, we could do a whole show about Electrical Parade and all that other stuff. Where do you want to start? There's something called Carnival De Lumiere. Was that the
Carnival
first one?
Carnival De Lumiere. Well, yes and no. It was the actual first produced show. As Epcot was in construction, being built, I had a friend, Adam Bezark, who is a very talented show designer and producer. And he was completing his degree at USC in theme park design. His professor was actually Dick Nunes's brother. And I had met Adam when he was sort of a interning at Disneyland, and he was assigned to follow me around, and we became friends. And we were talking about Epcot, and we said, you know, there's this big lagoon and it really ought to have something spectacular in it. And so we put together a pitch for a show we called the Aquatechinic Spectacular. And we pitched it to Dennis Despy, who was the vice president of entertainment at that time. And Dennis said, well, guys, I hate to tell you this, but Bob Yanni's already doing a show for the Epcot Lagoon. And it was called Carnival de Lumiere.
Uh-huh.
So we left the office dejected and thought, well, it was a good idea. We had fun creating it and pitching it. Well, not too long after that, I got a call from Bob, and Bob said, I'm doing this show, Carnival de Lumiere. I said, I know.
I've heard
it. And he said, I would like you to synthesize a soundtrack for the show. I said, okay, tell me the details. And he gave me this outline of a 25-minute show in 5 movements. And he said, I want it to be classical, but have a new sound. And Bob seemed to have this fascination with combining the old and the new. If you recall, the America on Parade was a vintage band organ combined with synthesizer. So here we were at Epcot, and it was a show celebrating cultures of the world, and specifically celebrations, pageants, fireworks throughout history and around the world. And he wanted classical music, but synthesized. At that time, Switched on Classics was a big hit on the radio. It was sort of a disco thing. And he said, like that, but without the drums. So I spent 4 to 6 weeks kind of going through the classical repertoire and trying to identify songs that were familiar and identifiable so that people would recognize the tunes. And then sort of like a jigsaw puzzle, tried to figure out how to put them together into the 5 different movements that would convey the different characters that Bob wanted for each section of the show.
Was there like a different song for each of the countries? It sounds perfect.
Well, there's actually, yeah, there's 10 to 12 different melodies in each of the 5 movements. They're mini medleys, if you will. And each one has a different character. There's one for celebrations on land, one for water spectacles, another one for parades and pageants, another one for fireworks. So given those different descriptions, I tried to pick themes that worked in that genre and put them together in a medley with some sort of character. For, you know, the water section was flowing and bubbly. The fireworks section was bombastic and dramatic. Parades, of course, is very martial and very parade-like. So I spent a couple of months in the studio, 6 days a week, 10 to 12 hours a day, just grinding away, because it ended up being 1,100 and something individual tracks and 52 individual pieces of music, each with up to 24 tracks. So it was a lot of work, working from the original scores in the original keys and fitting it all together. And it was actually one of the first projects that Entertainment had produced and mixed in the digital format.
Groundbreaking.
It was groundbreaking, and it also meant that when it came time to overlap the different sections and make the transitions, we were waiting a couple of minutes to hear a 3-second crossfade. Now, this is ancient technology, mind you. This is 1982 digital. Wow. It's not click and hear it like we have now. So it was tedious and time consuming, but we put the soundtrack together and went off to Florida.
Was it a good show?
Well, there were some technical issues. And the most egregious issue was that the visuals for the show, which had been meticulously selected and photographed, were presented in a way that they could not be seen by the guests.
It was on a barge, right?
Yes, using pretty much standard Kodak ectographic slide projectors at a distance of 500 feet.
Oh my God.
With rear projection screens and standard illumination. It just was not bright enough to have these complex images translate into a viable experience for the guest. And we had some other technical problems with trying to broadcast time code when there was a lot of radio interference in the area. We had some mishaps with massive amounts of fireworks being triggered all at the same time instead of over a course of 6 minutes.
Oh my gosh.
Which was a pretty spectacular failure. That
I evening. Bet that's a good finale in the middle.
And I think the show actually performed for guests maybe 5 or 6 times.
Wow. So most people don't even know about this show. That's
rare. It was very few people would have seen it. And as a result, Dick Nunes and Card Walker and the other honchos decided we're not going to keep this show, but we have all this hardware. What are we going to do with the hardware? Now, in addition to doing the soundtrack, I had been consulting and a part of the programming for the fountains and the fireworks and the projection. So I was sort of involved on the technical side as well as on the music side. And they decided that they wanted to keep the barges as if they could use them in a different show with different content and somehow address the visual complexity. And Adam and I put our heads together again and said, well, you know what? We've got an idea. And we asked Dennis, can we pitch our idea for a redo of the Lagoon show?
Oh, wow. And, is this the original idea you had to begin with?
No, this was reconsidered in light of hardware that existed at that time. The barges, fountain barges, fireworks barges, using the projection basically that was in place, but doing something with the visuals to make it more translatable. So we pitched putting the barges together in pairs to make the image size larger, changing the amount of detail in the images. We went from very complex pastel images of things that people would not recognize to a very high color, high contrast cartoon style. And we kept the music soundtrack. We edited it down a little bit shorter and we separated the show into 3 movements. First movement, land. Second movement, sea, which was the fountains. Third movement, sky, which was the fireworks section. And in each section, we tried to optimize the activity so that there was a fast pace and a good impact to the experience. So we worked the daylights out of those slide projectors in the first movement for 4 minutes. Then we moved to the fountains. We worked the heck out of those fountains for 3 minutes. Then we moved to the fireworks. And of course, if you've kept them that far, you've got them at fireworks. New World Fantasy was a success. It was a success with the public. It was a success visually. It was such a success that they said, we have to change the show for the next summer. And the problem was that everybody came out of the south side of World Showcase around to the North Shore, which was where the show was focused, and camped out before the show so they could get a good seat. That meant that people were coming out of shops and restaurants instead of staying in them.
Yep. Not so spending money.
That led to redevelopment of a show in the round format, which was Laserphonic Fantasy. And Adam and I reconsidered everything and looked at new things we could do with lasers, one of which was, I believe, the first water screen, where we projected lasers onto the back of basically water sprays on the top of the fountain barges from a center barge, which we called the laser barge. And there was a large globe that sat on top of that barge, which had fiber optics wrap around, really sort of an early incarnation of the Earth globe.
Sounds like it.
The fiber optics never lived up to the promise, but the water screens were something that did work very well. And we were very, very proud of that. We got an award for the artwork that we did for a segment called The Ice Skater, which everybody thought was a hologram, because it green lasers on water drops sparkling out in the middle of the air was one of those moments that really came across very well.
How perfect for EPCOT to really kick off this, first of all, a new technology, but just blowing people away. Like, people have never seen that before, you know, and that's so cool that it was such a hit.
Well, we discovered that effect by accident when we were up at WDI one day, or it was wet at that time, I guess. And we were looking at laser stuff, and somebody came through with a spray bottle of cleaning fluid or something, and the droplets went through the laser beam, and we said, wait a minute,
that's cool.
Can we do that? Oh my gosh. And so we took lasers to EPCOT, and we hooked up a hose on the side of a fountain barge and sprayed it off on the side and shot the laser through it. And,
what a cool experiment. Oh my gosh.
Put up Mickey Mouse ears, and it looked great. And so we said, okay, we got to do that.
You know, it's funny, when you just first said the name Laserphonic Fantasy, is that what it's called?
Yes.
That sounds like an EPCOT Lagoon show. Like all these shows have these names that just kind of sound like an EPCOT show.
Laserphonic Fantasy was a marketing name.
Sounds like it.
The original title was Rhapsody in Light.
Oh, interesting.
Classical music tie-in.
Yeah.
But that didn't have lasers in it, and it didn't sell well from a marketing perspective. So it became
Lasers. I got to get there and see those lasers.
That's right.
So did that one run for a long time?
That one ran for a few years. We introduced minor changes from year to year. That started in the summer of 84 and ran through the end of 86 and 87, I believe. And then the original Illuminations came in January of 88. At that time, there were these glow sticks and strings that were made of this material called Cyalume, which, you know, is glow, green glow. They're like safety markers and stuff like that. And they sell them at carnivals and so on. And we thought those glowing strings looked a lot like lasers. And we thought this would be a great thing for EPCOT to merchandise.
Oh yeah, good tie-in.
And Dick Nunes would have none of it. He said, it's too carnival, we don't want to do that, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, we arranged to do a demo one weekend, and we got a vendor to bring in and hand over 50,000 of these things to try and sell over the weekend. And within a couple of hours on the first evening, the marketing guy came backstage with a big wad of cash and said, I don't care what Dick says, we're doing this.
Yeah, let's make some money. Illuminations. When people think of EPCOT, I think they think of Illuminations. And it's been a part of the park for almost its entire history. What planted the seeds for that?
Well, Adam and I got a call from Ron Logan and Tom Craven, who was the technical director, and John Haupt, who was a lighting designer. And they said, we want you guys to come to dinner in Hollywood. We want to talk to you about a new show. So we said, okay. We went up, we had dinner, and they said, well, we have a title, and it's IllumiNations.
Pretty damn clever.
We need you to tell us what the show is.
Work backwards from the name. The name is great.
They had the name, and they had the idea that the pavilions all light up. Okay, so that gave us a good starting point. And then the question was, is it a world tour? Is it a medley? Is it, what is it? So we put together, again, a three-movement format where we had an introductory movement, and then we had the pavilion section in the center, and then we had the fireworks section at the end. So it was sort of a reimagining of the three-movement context and show, focusing the whole center section instead of on projections and so on, focusing on the pavilions. And we had searchlights that could move and point to each pavilion as it was introduced, and we picked music from each pavilion. And one of the things that we had to do was, this is where my synthesized soundtrack bid us farewell and hit the dust. But the arrangements from the first and third movement of Laserphonic Fantasy were kept, but re-recorded with a full orchestra. Wow. And the second movement was created from scratch with the help of Bruce Healy and Steve Scoria and Ken Whitcomb from Disneyland. Each was assigned different arrangements in that medley, and then we put it all together. And Bob Krogstad, who was a friend of Ron Logan, created the Illuminations theme, which is a beautiful piece of music, and did a really excellent job of setting up that show and setting a whole different mood for the presentation.
The visuals that come to mind with each different country lighting up, I mean, that is pretty cool. And that's never been done before. Most of the shows in the past were just Lagoon focused, right? So being able to focus it on each country and having the outline, such a cool idea. I mean, it's just lights and the trim, but really cool how they all did that.
Yeah, it really expanded the show and the whole impression of the place, which was important because the architecture of World Showcase is very, very beautiful. And the vista across the lagoon is very special. And so it was great to be able to do that. One of the things that we introduced at that time, which was also very new, was projection mapping. Now it's everywhere. Everybody's projecting on buildings and doing all
this
stuff.
Was it like gobos, or was it just photos, or was it video?
It was pretty much still artwork that was custom done. We projected on Germany, which had a lot of facade work where we could project. And we turned it into a gingerbread house, and we turned it into a toy shop. We projected the US Capitol on American Adventure. A lot of the other pavilions didn't provide us good flat surfaces to project on, but the ones that did work were very, very well received.
So that show started late 80s, ran throughout the whole 90s.
Yeah, January 88.
Wow, that's a solid run. And then it's so good, they couldn't lose the name for the next version of it.
Well, it was originally a marketing thing. It was kind of like Fantasy in the Sky fireworks was for several years. There were different shows, but it was just Fantasy in the Sky. It was the signature event for the nighttime. And Illuminations was created very much in that same mindset, which was, that is the name of the nighttime EPCOT show.
So how did it evolve throughout that decade?
Illuminations, as we first installed it, ran until Epcot's 25th, I believe. And then it was Illuminations 25, was reworked with new music and different programming. And then it was 1998, and it was Illuminations 98. And we're getting ready to do the Millennium at this time. Illuminations 98 had an A, B, and a C version that evolved as they tried to massage the music track and the programming for different reasons. It was 97 when I actually started on Reflections of Earth, once again, by sticking my foot in the door and saying, I have an idea. And
it works. You got to be persistent.
Electrical Parade, New World Fantasy, Reflections of Earth, all because I stuck my foot in the door and said, wait a minute.
Right. It's that fine line between, you know, being persistent and don't be annoying, but like, just, hey, when you're ready, I got an idea for you.
Well, I think of myself as a problem solver. You know, the original Electrical Parade, I said, this needs more impact because
you knew how to elevate it. That's so cool.
It's a better show than it currently is. What can I do to make it better? Then the Lagoon show was, again, look at the barges, look at the materials we have, look at the fireworks inventory that's already been ordered, and how can we reformat this into a better show than it was? And that's what we did. And during the development of the Millennium,
huge
deal. Yeah, there was a lot of discussion at the corporate level about, you know, how does Disney relate to it? What is it other than just another party celebrating the future, but it's a bigger number? What is it? What's so special about this one, this number turning over that makes it significant? What is going to bring people to the parks? How do we get them to experience something that is unique, appropriate, and that is affordable? And there had been several ideas discussed, some of them ridiculous, some of them...
Tell me about some of the silly ones. What was crazy?
Well, there was one idea to have a white horse walking across the water between the two islands.
Sure, why not? Keep Epcot weird.
And another show with big crane arms with lights and water, kind of what Harmonious is doing now, but
right.
With the technology of 1997, 1998, the design was an engineering challenge, and they spent a great deal of money not being able to pull it off. And so the clock was ticking, and that's when I said, well, okay, I'm familiar with everything we've done so far. I know how the Lagoon works. I can envision a show that pulls together all the things that have been talked about, and we'll come up with a new centerpiece. LED sign technology was pretty new at that time. We got a lot of signs out to the old short takeoff and landing strip adjacent to the Magic Kingdom. And we looked the signs from 600 feet away and said, which technology is gonna be the best at this distance in terms of color, image clarity, contrast, and so on. And picked a vendor and started developing this idea of an LED globe so that we would have some visual content. The idea, of course, being that the Earth would tell us its own story. And so that idea progressed, and it was affordable and doable. And we began the quest and pulled it off.
More than anything, that globe is so iconic to Epcot, and you know, when you think of an Epcot nighttime show, it's that globe is the first thing, and how ceremonial it was when, you know, a show that's been around that long, people get so excited just to see that barge come out, like, here's the globe, you know, and like, it's just so awesome, such a cool thing.
We talked about, you know, do we do the whole globe in LEDs, and I said, no, let's just do the continents. There was pushback. Well, why don't we do the oceans? Well, let's let the places where these things happened tell the story rather than the space between.
Well, that's the neatest part, is that the visuals in each country, in each continent are, you know, appropriate. And it, as it cycles through and rotates, I think it's way more dynamic to see just the silhouette of the continents.
Yeah, well, that was a challenge in and of itself, to make sure that the images appearing on each continent were somehow relevant to that physical location. And we went through scads and scads of images to try and pick the ones that were most easily recognized in a short period of time. And we did studies on how fast the globe would rotate so that we knew, okay, I can see that image long enough to recognize it before I have to change another image. We thought we were going to be using thousands and thousands of images, but I think we ended up using only a couple of hundred total.
Then there's the point of the show where it actually opens up and the inside rises. Tell me about that. How did that come to be?
Well, that was a lot of fun to try and tell the engineers, not only do you have to figure out how to build a globe TV screen, but it has to open up and then there has to be fire and fireworks coming out of it at the end. I got to say that Gerald Kaplan and the WDI guys really pulled off a good one there.
Did you know the show would last two decades?
No. The original financial plan was maybe it'll last 10 years, the investment 10 years. But thinking about the millennium and being relevant to the millennium, we were hoping 2 years, 3 years, maybe if we're lucky, five. But it kept going.
I didn't make it out there for the last showing of it, but you know, watching all the videos of it and people saying goodbye to it, it was pretty emotional for people to like say goodbye to that one.
Oh, it really was. We had a party. I invited as many of my original creative team and production team as could attend to join me at Epcot for the final show. And we had a private viewing location right by the China Bridge. And after the show, the Earth Globe is making its final exit of the lagoon. And as it drove by us and through the bridge, people were applauding.
Clapping to a piece of hardware, but it's a friend at that point, you know, it's part of
It really touched something in people, and I'm very, very pleased at that.
Well, you know, thinking about all this hardware that comes out, went back in, you know, in the 90s and early 2000s, there's something about, you know, showing up at Epcot, seeing this beautiful lake, and then later in the afternoon, you see these little boats coming out. Like, it's just like these little worker bees coming out, and like, that just helps the buzz of like getting excited, like, okay, it's time for Illuminations. And then once it gets dark and then the torches are lit and that really cool music, there's something about Epcot half an hour before the nighttime show starts that's pretty awesome. Did you have anything to do with the music on that?
No, we got lucky. Whoever picked that particular assortment of tunes that plays right up to the show.
It really helps get everyone pumped.
Did a great job. Yeah, they really captured sort of the festive multicultural mood.
Yeah.
And really does a great job of leading into the show.
Yeah, it's perfect just to set the mood, and to see a show like Illuminations was pretty cool. And it makes me, you know, want to go back to Mexico, get that cucumber jalapeno margarita, and just go watch this amazing fireworks show. And you know, the pyro getting shot from the outside going inward, and just everything about it, I absolutely love it. You know, you did 45 years of contributing to all this magic, and it sounds so cliche, but it really is, like, you were a big part of that. It's funny that you see yourself as a fixer guy, when I kind of just wish they went to you in the first place so you didn't have to fix it. I wonder if there would have been a trade-off, or did the end result turn out to be better because you did get to come in and fix it and kind of be the hero?
I guess I've arrived at that sort of self-definition of the fixer in retrospect and looking back at how things evolved. I didn't think I was fixing things at the time. I thought I was contributing to the new things, and just trying to come up with the best things that I could.
So that's amazing. You got to bring back the entire, you know, as many people as you could that worked on Reflections on Earth two decades later. I'm sure that was a super awesome time that, like, you never thought you'd have the chance to get that group and watch that show again. But yeah, what a weird time in history, let alone theme park history, but in the world. Big changes for the Walt Disney Company happened in 2020. They had to say goodbye to a lot of people. And that was the end of your time with Disney?
Yeah, I was one of the people that got the call that said, we're shutting down the parks and we'll see you later.
Wow. So that's not the end of your story. What happened?
No, it's not the end of my story.
No way.
You know, there's always something to do. It was sad to say goodbye to Disney, but I felt like I had trained people to take over for me, because I knew at some point I would probably be retiring or leaving the company. It wasn't my decision. It wasn't their decision. It was COVID that made it happen. So can't really complain. It's just no hard feelings. Things.
It's unfortunate.
You're part of history and you take the consequences. I was able to continue working with theme parks and parades. I picked up a gig working for Universal Studios, helped them to launch their new theme park in Beijing, China last year. Spent 5 months in China.
Wow, what a time to be in China.
teaching people what parades were all about and creating a control system for them so that their inaugural parade could live up to amazing standards. Some of the largest and most beautiful floats that I've ever seen, designed by Steve Bass, who also did a bunch of stuff for Disney, and directed by Sylvia Hasse.
He did Lion King parade too, I think, right?
That's correct, yeah. And so we opened that park in September. And it was an interesting time to be in China because we went over right in the thick of the COVID lockdown. And we had 4 weeks of quarantine to survive before we could get on site and actually begin working. But to bring a whole theme park from the ground up, all the audio for all the attractions, the BGM, the parade, all of that was...
So not just the parade route, the entire park.
The company that I'm working through now, Audio by the Bay, did all of the on-site audio installation and programming. And so it was a massive effort. We had a total of 14 people on the ground at various times during the final stages of construction and putting together the floats and getting them on the street.
All right, Don, I think it's safe to say you wrote the book on almost everything: parade audio, control systems, nighttime spectaculars, BGM. Like, it's endless. I can't thank you enough for spending some time with me talking about all this fun stuff. There's a lot more to talk about, and hopefully maybe we could chat again in the future. There's some fun stuff you did for Islands of Adventure. You did a lot of work with Radio City Music Hall. Your two number one CDs. I think there's a lot more that we could talk about, but like I said, it's nice to focus on one thing at a time, because I'm so scatterbrained, I would go everywhere. But EPCOT, that's where it's at. So I really love the show. I love talking to you, and I hope to have you back. Where can people find you?
They can go to my website, dondorsey.com. Made it simple.
Yeah, that makes sense.
There's on Facebook, there's a Fans of Don Dorsey page that people can join. And I post things there from time to time and answer questions. And there's pictures from various projects of the past from time to time. So join in and have a look.
That's awesome. And if anyone watching this has photos of any of these shows, please maybe post them on Don Dorsey's Facebook page. I think that'd be kind of cool. Share that. And I'm sure he'll give you some fun tidbits about it. But hey, thanks again. I'll talk to you soon.
Great. Good night, Sam.
Night. And thanks everybody for watching episode 5 of Art of the Experience. This one was special. Don Dorsey, thank you so much. All right, have a good one, everyone. Bye.